Let's talk about day three of the Jets draft. What is going on, guys? Welcome back to Talking Jets with Tego. My name is Tego, and today we're going to be talking about, well, the New York Jets draft day three, all the undrafted free agents we did, all of the trades, all of the everything. So this video might be a little bit longer than other videos, but I did want to spend the time to really talk about this. The New York Jets made 5 picks on day three, and they traded in the draft overall 6 times. If you don't include the day one trade where we traded back from 10 to 11 or the Malachi Corley trade up, then we traded 4 times in the 4th, the 5th, the 6th, and the 7th round in day three of the Jets draft. Now, let's talk about the players. We'll talk about the trades. We'll talk about the JFM trade and then the UDFAs that we brought on. So strap yourselves in. I think personally that day two was highlighted by specifically 2 picks, and that is the Braylon Allen pick in the 4th round, round 4, pick 134, and then the other running back pick, Isaiah Davis out of South Dakota State, round 5, pick 173. Now, why do I think that these were the highlights of the day three draft picks? Well, because I think we all expected a Braylon Allen, a running back pick in round 4. I believe Joe Douglas has yet to go a draft where he has not taken a running back, period. Because it was Michael Carter, then it was Breece Hall, then it was Israel Abanikanda, and now it's been Braylon Allen. I do not think he's gone through a draft where he has not brought in a, I think, LaMichael Perine, I think, was the draft before that. So besides the point, Joe Douglas invests in the run game. It's the same way that he has never gone a draft without taking an offensive lineman, which is just smart business. Throw assets at the position until it gets fixed, right? But double dipping with Braylon Allen and then later Isaiah Davis, 2 players that have, I don't want to say similar skill sets, because I think that Braylon Allen is a much heavier runner and much stronger runner than Isaiah Davis, but they're both very, very strong guys that hate to get tackled, guys who like running through their opponents and doing all of that. And so with all of that being said, The biggest takeaway I have from this is that the New York Jets are investing heavily in making sure that, one, they can play with a lead, right? Because that's what they want to do. But also, they want to be a hard out. And like, what I mean by that is, putting it into hockey terms, you have your finesse hockey teams, but then you have your teams that like you just hate playing. And it's not because they're so skilled, and it's not just because they play really, really hard. I think a perfect example of this is the Boston Bruins. And they're the first thing that comes to my head because I hate the Boston Bruins and they've been plaguing my Maple Leafs for a long time. But while they do have skill in Boston, they're just a really hard out. They play aggressive, they play physical, and that's what the New York Jets are going to do. And you see that with all of the picks that they're making in this draft class, except for like 2. And the 2, I think, is Olufashanu, who's more of a finesse guy. I don't think he's a bruiser, I want to just beat you up kind of guy. And that's totally fine. I like the finesse that he has in pass protection. He can learn to get mean and nasty in the run game. And then, like, Jordan Travis, who we'll talk about in a second. The New York Jets are really going to run the ball. They're going to be a power running team. They're going to make teams hate playing the New York Jets. And this is a very, very, very strong comparison, and I'm not saying that both of these guys are going to be as good as Derrick Henry, but when you want to think about what the New York Jets run game might start to look like, is think about what the Tennessee Titans did for all of those years with Derrick Henry in that offensive line, because we do have connections to that building, and that style of running coming to the New York Jets is going, we're going to be a ground and pound team, and that's very, very clear with the moves and the picks that we've made. Continuing on with the picks in day 3, Jordan Travis, the quarterback out of Florida State, taking a pick 5, pick round 5, pick 171. Now, I am going to be a little critical here. I totally understand why you're going to take a quarterback in the middle rounds. I totally get it. And Jordan Travis is being put in like the perfect situation for him to learn, for him to develop into something for the New York Jets. There is no ifs, ands, or buts about it. He really is in the perfect spot. There are a couple of problems that I have with this kind of pick. One is that Jordan Travis is an older prospect. He is already, or he is about to turn 24 years old. So the question has to be asked, how close is he to his ceiling in terms of the level of play that he can achieve, even with the mentorship of Aaron Rodgers and all of those guys? So I do have questions there. And then the other problem that I have with it is just fundamentally, he's got some things that I question. And again, totally fine with the pick, but this is the one pick where in kind of the whole draft where I'm just like, I don't know about this pick. I really didn't want Jordan Travis. I was more of a Michael Pratt guy, but in all honesty, I didn't want any of these quarterbacks that were going to be available in rounds 4 or 5. I thought all of them were, I just don't think that they're going to turn into anything at the NFL level. I really hope that I'm wrong. I hope that Jordan Travis and all of the conversations that you have about all of the stuff that he does off of the field and all of the really good teammate and all of that stuff can help him, and sitting behind two veterans, and I mean like really good veterans, in Aaron Rodgers, future Hall of Famer, Tyrod Taylor, who's been everywhere and gone through everything as a quarterback, from being QB1 to being the backup to being the mentor to being everything that you can think under the sun, is really going to help him develop and turn into hopefully our future game manager, hopefully our future quarterback, hopefully a guy that we can use. But I don't have a ton of faith in that panning out that way. And then going on with the last two picks, one in round 5, Quantez Stiggers, the defensive back from the Toronto Argonauts. Stiggers is a really interesting story. For those of you who don't know, he didn't actually play in college at all. Right out of high school, he went pro and played in the fan-controlled league, and then from there went to the CFL and then got drafted to the New York Jets. And I didn't know the rules, but if you don't go to college, you still have to declare if you want to go to the NFL, and that's why he couldn't just directly sign with a team, even though he was at the CFL. He's projected to be more of a project kind of a guy. He's got a lot of traits and things like that, and finding where he's going to live in the NFL level is going to be the task of our defensive back coaches. And I trust our defensive back coaches more than probably any of our coaches on the team. Any coach on the defensive side of the ball is absolutely phenomenal. Look at the unit that they've created. So getting a project like Stiggers is an interesting one, especially because we're going to be losing a ton of players in the defensive back room next year, in the safety room and in the cornerback room. And mystery relevant pick number 7, Jalen Key, the defensive back out of Alabama. Just another defensive back project. See what he can turn into. See if he can maybe win a role. And again, going into one of the better cornerback rooms in the NFL, learning from those guys, learning from our DB coaches, just a guy with some traits who went to a big school who maybe you can kind of rely on and see what happens. Now let's talk about all the trades that happened, because I'm not a fan of any of them, period. I will say that the message that I got from the trades is that, one, Joe Douglas and Robert Saleh seem more than secure in their jobs. They think that they have a team that can go and win, and that is a good confidence to have in your team, because trading a 4th-round pick this year for a 3rd-round pick next year straight up tells me that you think you're going to be around to make that 3rd-round pick next year. And I like the confidence that says from your general manager and your head coach, but there were players in the 4th round that I would have loved to have taken that would have made this team much, much better. A couple of trade backs and all of that stuff, and building up these assets and all, it just always kind of felt weird. Why did we trade back and then trade back into round 5 to take Jordan Travis if you wanted the quarterback? Why would you just, like, it's just a lot of weird situations. I didn't love all of the moving that we did, but you're going to have to trust Joe Douglas. But I think the biggest trade that surprised everybody, I think the biggest trade that surprised me, was Jonathan Franklin Myers being traded to the Denver Broncos for a 2026 6th-round pick, which just, man, I just don't get it. That pick to me doesn't really make a ton of sense. That trade, I'm sorry, doesn't make a ton of sense. The New York Jets do have a lot of really, really interesting and like just good players on the defensive line, but not so much that we can give up one of our key pieces. People like to sleep on Jonathan Franklin Myers, and I don't necessarily understand why, but I think one of the things that we all mistakenly took in our heads was that Hassan Reddick was brought in to be the Bryce Huff replacement, or compensation and all of those things, when in reality, I think the truth is more closely that JJ was taken to be the Jermaine Johnson. Jermaine Johnson was taken to be the Jonathan Franklin Myers replacement, and that's what we're seeing him turn into now. Hassan Reddick, Jermaine Johnson was brought in to be the Carl Lawson replacement, I'm sorry, and we see that now. But in reality, it's the JFM replacement. Hassan Reddick is the Carl Lawson replacement, and Will McDonald is the Bryce Huff replacement, and that's the new defensive line. Now, I totally get why you would feel confident moving on from JFM if JJ is going to play in that role. JJ is a phenomenal defensive end who can set the run and do all of those things, and Hassan Reddick is a great, great pass rusher, but now we're just not as deep. The flexibility to bump JFM inside on NASCAR packages is now gone. Do you have faith that a guy like Kinlaw and Solomon Thomas can play in that role? And this is where our UDFAs come in as well, because now there's a spot on that defensive line that needs to be won. And there are specifically three players that I look at on our undrafted free agent list that I think can legitimately make the roster. Those three players are, well, I'm going to list all of them. Thanks to Dom C. for this list. UDFA signing so far: North Carolina State cornerback Shaheem Battle, Michigan edge Braden McGregor, Arkansas offensive lineman Brady Latham, San Jose State safety linebacker Trey Jenkins, Tulane defensive back Jarius Monroe, Miami defensive tackle Leonard Taylor III, Army outside linebacker Kiarlo Jimmy, Alabama tight end Lincoln Sefik, and ECU outside linebacker Jerry Lewis. And the three players that really stick out to me as legitimately can possibly make the roster is, I think he's on the roster week one. Like, this is, I feel really confident with this, is Miami defensive tackle Leonard Taylor. Leonard Taylor was a guy that I really wanted to draft in like rounds 4 or 5. To see him go all of day three, not get taken, is absolutely blows my mind. Leonard Taylor, I think, has a really, really, really good skill set and is just another, like, to an extreme sense at this point, a misutilized asset at Miami. He played at the wrong position at Miami. They used him as a one tech, as a nose tackle, instead of the defensive tackle as a three tech that they should use him as. And that gives us a great ton of flexibility because we can use an athlete like that. He had a 28.3% pass rush win rate playing at a three tech, but most of his reps came inside as a one tech. And so there's a guy that is totally, I think, going to make the roster. But the other guy to keep in mind is Michigan edge Braden McGregor. He's got a ton of traits. We do have a hole now in the edge room that needs to be filled. There is an opportunity there, but things to keep in mind, things to expect moving forward. My expectation is Hassan Reddick is going to be getting a extension soon, that this isn't just a one and done, that we want him on the team for a while, which makes sense. You wouldn't do the JFM trade, especially with a guy who you had a controlled contract on, even if he wouldn't take less money, if you don't have a backup plan long term. So I think Hassan Reddick is going to get extended, but also this means that I think Will McDonald's role is going to take a massive, massive step up. Let's see what happens. There's a lot of things that can still go on. Let me know what you guys think about everything that we saw on day 3 in the comment section below. And last but not least, go Jets.